Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Ask Mr. Sutton if you have an invocation for me, please.
Thank you. If we could take a moment, please. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for another beautiful day. Be with us as we deliberate the county's business tonight. Our Heavenly Father, please help us realize that the world that we live in has many problems, and there are solutions. And without proper leadership, without determination, fortitude, honesty, integrity, and ethics, and a belief in you as our Lord and Savior, that these solutions will never be accomplished. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, I'm going to call on Ms. Vaughn to do a presentation, and if you would.
I had the great honor on the 31st of July to go to the Junior Police Academy graduation ceremonies, the 2009 graduation ceremonies at the Ramada Inn. And I was amazed at what I saw. There were quite a few young ladies and gentlemen that were graduating from the police academy. They did make a special thank you to a lot of folks, Burlington City Council, as well as Chief Mike Williams, Burlington Police Department, Graham City Council, and Chief Jay Smith, Burlington Fire Department, Alamance County Board of Commissioners, Elon University, Jeff Pritchett from the Graham Police Department, Alamance Burlington Schools, and Sheriff Terry Johnson and his force. I was amazed. Sheriff was there also. I was amazed at these young people. There were quite a few people that worked very hard to put these kids through boot camp. Saw the pictures of what was going on. You know it was boot camp. So I thank everybody that participated. Sheriff's Department, Police Department, Graham, and Burlington. I wish more of you could attend these graduation ceremonies. There was a lot of hard work on the part of the police and sheriff's departments and these kids. You would have been amazed. And they've gotten a great start. I hope we can put this plaque, which is lovely, you have yours up, put this plaque up in a very prominent place. I also want to say thanks to John Glenn, who really started this program here in Burlington when he was chief in Burlington. So if you'll relay that to him, thank you. And thank you.
It's on the sheet. Okay. At this time, I'll open the public comments, and I don't think we have any. Okay. You will just put your name on here, Mr. Jeffrey.
Sorry about that.
I won't hit you hard.
Just give a demerit for it.
Yeah, I've been here for a while, so I forgot procedures.
We missed you.
Yeah, I bet you did.
You don't want to bother that one.
That's great. One question, actually. Sorry?
Give your name.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, Peter Childers.
Okay.
For Emmett Curl, I understand he's giving a presentation tonight. Is Emmett, Mr. Curl?
Mr. Curl is over there.
Okay, great. And this concerns the reevaluation. I read in the Alamance News that a little while back there were several millions of dollars of reevaluation reductions done. And reading the article, if I can remember it correctly, it seemed that a lot of these reevaluations were done across the desk. On kind of an ad hoc basis, I guess, or an informal basis. And I just want clarification on that, if Mr. Krill maybe knows, because it seemed that this was done after Kim Horton left and before Mr. Krill came on stream. And I guess what I'm concerned about is that I know there was a lot of political pressure on the tax department to get rid of angry people. And I just want to make sure that these reevaluations were done according to proper appraisal practice and not simply just to get rid of angry people. So that's my understanding right now of possibly how it was done, because across the desk corrections were, my understanding was for obvious errors, you know, like the address was wrong or the acreage was wrong or square footage or something like that. But what I was concerned about is that how many of these properties were actually visited to justify those lowered valuations. So if anyone can answer that for me, I'd appreciate it.
Can you answer that, Mr. Kerr? Or
in the presentation.
Kim Burgess?
Is it going to be in? Am I kind of getting ahead of you then?
Sort of.
Okay.
That's right.
Okay. All right. So if it's going to be taken care of in the presentation, then that's all I had to say.
All right.
Thank you.
And we have no more public comments, so I'm going to close the public comments at this time. And I'll ask Mr. Curl to come forward with his presentation of the tax revaluation update.
Thank you. I appreciate this opportunity, and thank you for the lead-in. I appreciate that. It was very good. First, the purpose in the reappraisal, let me just cover that. I know this is redundant, but I want everybody to make sure reappraisals are for the purpose of equalization of property values within the real estate class and the personal property class. Personal property is revalued every year, so over time, it gets out of sync with real estate. We want to bring that back up when you do it. And then real estate within itself, areas of the county and classes of real estate go up at different rates depending on economic pressures. That's the other purpose in the reappraisal thing. There are a lot of appeals. There were 16,000 appeals in this reappraisal. That's a little bit out of kilter. Now, I dissected that or attempted to as well as could. We had about 8,000, which I consider normal appeals in any reappraisal process of this county of this size. That's normal. There were 8,000 that weren't. Most of those came about in two areas. Changing software systems in midstream created about half of those. About another half, the other remaining half, came from condition factors that did not migrate over into software or were taken off intentionally. And when I say condition factors on land, I'm talking about land that won't perk. And a sundry of topo, shape, size, all sorts of conditions that influence how a piece of property is bought and sold. So those things caused the extra, I'd say 4,000 appeals. So you take those out, you had a normal appraisal process. What the good news is, as of close of business today, they have been handled down to only 1,310. Now, to address the situation, a question that was asked at the beginning in the public comment, the 16,000 were worked through. There was not any rush in that process. This is mass appraisal. We don't do fee quality work. We don't do $250 to $400 appraisals on each parcel of property. You can't afford that. These were done for less than $20 a parcel countywide. And that's pretty much the state practice. The county from where I came, about 1975, was pretty much what it cost to do the appraisal in that jurisdiction. Adjoining counties spend somewhere around the $20 mark. So that's normal. You're in the ballpark there. Now, errors may occur in that process, but if they are, we try to correct them. We try not to make as many as we can. But in my experience over the last 30-some years, I would say that lion's share of errors that are made that cause things to be inequitable, not necessarily at market. If everything's at 50% of value, we're in good shape. If everything's at 150% of value, we're still in good shape. It's when parts at 50 and parts at 150 is when we're not. So that this, the goal is to keep everything right around 100% as much as we can. Now, in the area of the sales ratio study, which determines how the quality of your revaluation. The prior to January 1, the state did that, and you're familiar with the results of that that study. I've looked at everything that has sold since January, tried to take out, there was some new construction in there where the we won't pick up and add the houses to that until next year or next spring. So I didn't include those, and then the stuff on the upper end we tried to clean up and everything. Bottom line, at 338 sales, I found the level of assessment around 101 with the coefficient. Now, what that is how dispersed around that 101% are those sales, and they are roughly 12 points. The IAAO, or the International Association of Assessing Officers, has a study that says anything 15 points or less is considered a good revaluation, and you're at 12 points on each side of that 101. Now, prior, if you look at sales prior, you're around 99%. So at 101 with the economy like it is, I consider that very, very good. So you're in good shape there. In cleaning up the appeals process, the staff and the previous contractor went through roughly 16,000 in about 3 months. And as far as I can tell, there was if there were things that were done incorrectly, we brought back to the Board of ENR, and we've adjusted some of those if they were perceived to be out of kilter. I know of a couple of dozen and a whole subdivision that have been brought back and actually raised slightly. So to get those things back in line. Are they perfect? This is mass appraisal again. It's a very good job overall, something that you will take you through the next years, I think, quite comfortably. Now, we're at the Board of ENR. At the close of business today, we had 1,310 appeals. Staff has worked through 528 of those with 726. They're going through roughly 120 to 160 per week. So I think sometime the first or second week of September, they will be basically in two buckets. One bucket is this customer has been contacted and he has accepted the market appraisal of his property. The other bucket is they want to come talk to the commissioners themselves, Board of Equalization Review themselves. And there's roughly 56 parcels in that bucket today. I think that'll be around 250 in that bucket when we get through. And that's parcels, not individuals. Some people have multiple parcels in that bucket. We're tracking how many each staff member does, and we're getting some of that in good shape. So to be through, I'm hoping by the middle of October. Now, one other thing that I've always thought was interesting, and forgive me, I'm a numbers person. I like to know who's affected when we do these reappraisal projects. And the only data that I could get together was residential, which included most of your vacant land, commercial, industrial, and then parcels that are in what we call the agricultural use category. I looked at 2008 value, compared it to the 2009, and here's what I found. 14% increase was in the real residential and vacant land overall. 18% was in the commercial category. That could change a little bit because we still have some pretty large parcels of value in the Board of ENR. Industrial decreased 4%. The land and agricultural use program increased 7%. Overall, it was a 14% increase over an 8-year period of time. Personally, that's the smallest increase I have seen in an 8-year program in my career. So I've been around 100 to 300% increases. So I think your turmoil and your problems occurred primarily from that data conversion, and I would say that was probably 75% of it was caused by that. That's the best I could tell at this point. Now, tax bills have gone out. Even on the properties that are under appeal, we have mailed the bills so they could get advantage of the discount. If the appeal is not completed, by the time they can pay and get their discount, then any refund will be going out as soon as the appeal has been finished. Within a day or two, or worst cases a week, the adjusted bill goes out right behind it on those 1,300. So that's in process. Phone activity, I thought was extremely light. Can't really tell if everybody's getting through that wants to get through. But anyway, we've made some changes to try to make sure phones is getting answered as best we can with the configuration of equipment that we have. We've started some training within the office to bring people's knowledge levels up, moving some things around. So some of that's going on. Now, I've gone through as much as I had on my agenda. I did not want to keep you long. So I would, if you have questions, I'd like to hear what's on your minds.
I understand there were about 10 counties statewide that were in the eight-year cycle that we were in. Is that correct?
Sounds right. A lot of people backed off. I think the cycle coming up, I only know of two. So everybody that can hold off is holding off. But if you were at 8 years, you'd take legislation to hold off by the General Assembly.
I understand there were like 8 to 10.
Sounds right.
Would you speculate that our increase was the lowest of all of those?
Not without doing some research.
I believe that statistic would bear out, probably.
I think you're correct, and the reason I say that, I'm involved in one before I came here, or actually two. One, it's going in effect in 2010, one that goes in effect in 2011. One I would have thought, which is adjacent, it's actually Johnson County, and I've looked at about 300 neighborhoods out of 400 that I was assigned to look at. And in that, the lot values were not changing more than 3 to 5%. And the building values, I was anticipating about a 12% increase in structure value to make the sales work out that I was looking at. And actually, the flyers pulling out of the box that real estate agents had in front of the houses offering for sale. When I look at the existing value from 8 years ago and I look at those sales, I'd say 11% is probably about all Alton's going to do. And that was on the side of the county next to Wake, which is what... and Wake would generate the highest increase. Land values in that jurisdiction, acreage tracts might do 75 to 80%, but it's a limited number of parcels. They're getting squeezed too, and that causes land values to rise. But there would be some much more significant increases, except there's a lot of land here. I'm finding out those are perk, and that's a lot of the conditions that were lost. I don't know why, but I've always, they're hard to overcome if something doesn't work. You can't fix that very well.
Is that something that would have come from changing the software?
Yes, sir. It's a flag that's in a given field, and if it's not migrated over and populate in the new correctly and identified correctly, yes. And I think that was a lion's share of about 4,000 fields. Best we could identify. And we're cleaning that up. The Board of Equalization Review is very dedicated to make sure everything is as equitable as they can do. And they're sitting there as the they're weighing the evidence from the county and weighing the evidence from the citizen and then making this decision. Not unlike a judge and jury. So we're pleased with that.
Now, I think what Mr. Childers wanted to know, did somebody actually go out and look at some of these properties? And I know they did.
Yes. Whenever it was thought to be justified, staff went and looked, contractor went and looked. But not in every case.
Exactly.
It's when things needed to be looked at, they were looked at. And there was sufficient resource to get looked at what needed to be. But I will tell you this, you have some very good tools in your GIS system with aerials, topography. You can actually tell more from some of those tools than you can standing out in the middle of the piece of property.
Exactly. I think that in itself was some
cure for some of the problems that were there by just looking at the GIS.
But a lot of that is available and has been utilized quite extensively.
Whenever Kim came and gave us $152,000 for the average home value in Alamance County, did you notice that? Or
I had not. I didn't think to look at that.
Okay, because I feel like that's too high. I've been in real estate since 96, and I just feel like that, I don't think that that's a good average of houses in Alamance County, because I just feel like you can't put McIntosh on the lake with all the other old houses in Pleasant Grove, which had the highest increase in value of anywhere, and I used to live there, and the houses out there, there's not $1 million house out there. I'm probably not a $500 million house out there. So, you know, and if you could
here's the methodology I will use. I will take everything that's 5 acres or less, if I can get this query put together.
Okay.
5 acres or less with a residential house, and I will take and sum the land value and building value and divide by the number of parcels, and that'll give us the average, and then I'll try to do something on a per square foot basis as well. Okay. To see what that comes out.
I mean, I just felt like $152,000 for the average house in Alamance County, because I've lived here all my life. And
I will put that together in a formal memo and give to Mr. Huntsett, and he can distribute it back to you.
Thank you. Any more questions?
Thank you all very
thank
much.
Thank you, we appreciate you.
And I will see you maybe again.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
At this time, I'm going to open the public hearings. The first is the economic incentives, and I will. Do we have any comments from the floor?
Hey, Max Williams should be.
Yeah. Oh, there's Mac. Hey, Mac.
Good evening, Madam Chairman and Commissioners. My name is Mac Williams. I'm President of the Chamber of Commerce, and as part of my role there, I'm also the Economic Development Agent for the county. And in that role, over the course of this past year, I have been working with a German company called Indelor, who has been on a search for a site to set up their first U.S. production facility. And we have been narrowing in on a site in Graham, North Carolina, an existing building, and are here tonight to complete a process that was begun a few months ago with respect to economic incentives. It has been a competitive circumstance where there were multiple locations in contention, and the issue of incentives came up during that process. A tentative offer was made, subject to a process like that we're going to tonight. And we are here tonight to introduce the project formally to you. The owner or representative of the owner of the company is here, as well as a principal administrator of the company. Sebastian Fengler, F-E-N-G-L-E-R, is here. It's a family-owned business. And Sebastian is a part of the family that is owns the business, and he will be here managing the facility. And we also have a gentleman by the name of Byron Wall, who has been in the in related business for a long time in his career, and is going to be part of the management team with the company wherever they locate. And we hope it's going to be here in Alamance County. So with that, I am going to introduce Byron and Sebastian. I don't know which order they'll come up in. I'll let them decide that. But they will tell you about the company, what they do, and be prepared to answer any questions you or the public may have. And I'll also be able to answer any questions you may have of me. So with that, if I may, I introduce Sebastian.
This is Sebastian Fengler.
Hello, Sebastian.
Hi, Byron.
Hello.
Thanks, Matt.
You're welcome.
Madam Chairman, Commissioners, I'd like to give you a brief overview of who we are as a company. And I thought that in order to do that, it'd be best for me to talk to you a little bit about the man who founded the company, and is the current owner still of the company, who also happens to be my father. So I know him quite well. Well, his name is Ervin Fenn, E-R-W-I-N, as in the town in North Carolina, which seems to be named after Germans. Erwin Fengler grew up amidst poverty and destruction of post-war Germany, and out of high school, he began a three-year apprenticeship as a chemical engineer and found his first steady employment with a company called Thyssen. You might have heard of the big steel manufacturer, and they make elevators and things like that now. But he used to work with them as a chemical engineer. And 3 years later, he was hired by adhesives manufacturer PKL, small company, where he gained his expertise on polymerization. So in short order, he became interested in developing his own polymer emulsion products. And within 4 years of working for the company, he was leading the development of an emulsion product line, enabling PKL to become independent of its emulsion suppliers. And furthermore, his developments expanded the scope of PKL's operations to the productions of adhesives for wallpaper, which dramatically increased the company's turnover. So because of his success with this business, he was offered a position as technical director at Europe's biggest wallpaper manufacturer, and they're called Rasch, R-A-S-C-H, and they're located in Bramstedt, Germany, which is a small town. This was in 1971, and at this point of his life, he already had ideas to eventually run his own company. And so he saw the management experience he would gain at Rasch as an important preparation for his future endeavors. 7 years later, so in 1978, despite a promotional offer from the company, he decided that it was worth the risk to sever ties with his employer and start his own company. And this is where Indolor comes into the picture. So 1978 is when we were founded. We started from scratch to become Europe's second biggest producer of polymer emulsions for water-based printing and overprint applications. The products developed by my father were manufactured for Indolor at first by other companies for us until we built our first production site in 1988. Although accompanied by substantial costs, the ability to manufacture our own products enabled us to establish ourselves as an important actor in the German polymer market. At this stage, we had just begun to produce polymer emulsions for water-based printing applications. After the reunification of Germany, we opened another site in Bitterfeld, East Germany, in 1997. And in 2002, this facility was expanded to include solid resin production. Solid resin they're like clear beads. They look like, just like clear beads. And they're solid polymer products that you use in emulsions to, and Byron will tell you more about the technical process of that, but they're used in polymer emulsions to enhance the quality of them. And once we had the solid resin production up running, this really proved to be a stepping stone for us as a company to enter the graphic arts market with full force. So because these solid resin products are necessary for the manufacture of overprint products, our exclusively water-based and eco-friendly products immediately occupied a substantial niche in this market because people were looking for high-quality products that were not manufactured by many companies at the time. So in conjunction with our much-emphasized technical customer service, this enabled our company to increase its turnover from 6 million euros in 2001 to 60 million euros in 2008. So a tenfold increase in 7 years, mostly due to the solid resin. Now, even in what have been adverse economic times for many businesses, Indolor has been stable and continued to grow at a rate of 10 to 15%. And we've historically emerged from economic crises stronger than before. As a result of these developments, we're now operating independent of banks or lending institutions and can make investments entirely out of our own cash flow. How is this possible? The values attached to being a family-owned company is what we believe has been a major contribution to our success. And there's a real connection between the investments we make as a family and the consequences it has for us. So all our major financial decisions are patiently contemplated and planned. And investments are made exclusively in relation to the company. So there's no speculation in stocks or any investments unrelated to the company. Accountability and responsibility are concepts that Indolor embodies not only in its solid financial structure, but also in dealing with its employees. So because of our steady growth and responsible management, there have not been any business-related layoffs in 30 years. When we have more than 130 employees in Europe. We continue to be 100% family-owned, and there are no plans for us to ever be a publicly traded entity. So now that we're entering the second generation of the family business, we continue to strive for moderate, sensible, and sustainable growth. And this means a steady expansion of our production capacities according to demand. So we're demand-driven, which means that there's a draw for us to enter the U.S. market. All our clients from Europe are over here asking us to basically build a production side. So our goal is to, here in Graham, translate our successful European model to the graphic arts market in America, where we believe that we can, in the next 3 to 5 years, obtain a market share of about 10 to 20% in the graphic arts market. So we think the conditions for a successful entry into the American market are all in place. And out of a variety of possible sites in the different states in the Southeast, we've chosen Graham as the main contender for the establishment of our American headquarters. So from here, we would actually be shipping and producing products for the entire American continent. And we believe Indolor's investment would be of lasting value to the community, not just because of the jobs we would create here over the next 2 years, but also because of our plans for sustainable expansion over the next decade. So as demand continues, we will expand the facility and hire more employees. And you might know this, but our industry in general is not as job intensive as most manufacturing industries. So our commitment to continuous investment in this project will assure long-term benefits to both our employees and the community as a whole, even if the numbers of employees aren't as they would be with a, let's say, a car manufacturing company. So if there are any questions at this point, I'll be happy to answer them, or if they're related to specifically what we do here in Graham, it might be better to address them to Byron, because he's been specifically doing things here in the U.S. and.
Well, yeah, I do, but you may wait to Byron.
Let me just speak real quick. First. I can also give you a copy of some of the information I just gave you if you wanted to.
Sure, sure.
Okay.
I'll do it.
All right. Or Byron will. So.
Thank you.
One more.
I can do what I got to do in very short order, and then we'll get to the questions. I just want to repeat a little bit of what Sebastian's had to say and emphasize that Indolor America already has a real good customer base here in North America. And American companies right now have a real strong pull for their product because it's a very high quality product. And Indolor has a reputation in Europe of being an extremely reliable partner and a long-term partner. So that's how they gained their reputation. And I would think those would all be qualities that would be important here. Basically, the American and international competitors of Indolor have consolidated much of their business in North America, like with other industries. And American customers are anxious to have the competition here, and that's why there's such a strong pull. Aside from Indolor, everyone else is consolidated. So the search for an American location for Indolore has been a rather long one for us. We looked for the past year at some joint manufacturing opportunities first. We also looked at various ways to put ourselves together with other companies, but we could see in pretty short order that this move was important enough that we needed to go out and start our own manufacturing. So basically, we conducted a search. We visited five different states in the southeast. We visited rather exhaustively. We looked at a number of locations in each state. Eventually, we decided to focus on North Carolina, and we looked all over the state. We were to the mountainside. We looked a little bit to the east, and we decided ultimately to focus on central North Carolina. From the perspective of our customers, it makes a lot of sense logistically. It's an absolutely perfect location. We looked at a lot of locations, but we looked seriously at 18 locations in central North Carolina. We narrowed that candidate pool down to three candidates. And the property that we're looking at in Graham is the present site of Seco Technologies. They've phased down their operations some time ago, and they decided to put their property on the market, so we saw it. And this is just a story you don't hear too often. We want to come in, reinvent that property, make a strong capital investment, and create jobs. It's a good location for us from a logistics perspective. And the site has an existing layout and set of buildings that just happen to match what we're looking for. So we're presently in the due diligence period still, but we've been at it for a little bit. So as long as everything with the property and the project proves successful, we're hoping to close here in a matter of weeks. So Graham seems to be an excellent location for us. And we're already starting to receive resumes from individuals who have heard about us just recently, and we're looking forward to starting work. So we're open to any questions.
Commissioners?
Yeah, I did have some questions because this was all new to me, so I started doing some check and investigating
sure.
and so forth.
Great.
Now, from what I've been able to find, that this is based on petroleum products.
In plastics. Part, correct.
Okay. And what I was able to find that they insinuated there would be numerous environmental exposures. How does this affect our environment?
Who were they?
talking about polymer manufacturing
right.
can result in numerous environmental exposures. Do you know anything about that? Is that a possibility? Does manufacturing this hurt? Would this hurt our environment?
Well, as you mentioned, polymers are made from petroleum products. Just like gasoline is a petroleum product.
Correct.
And petroleum products come with instructions, procedures that you have to be careful with. And, from the perspective of the environment, it's incumbent on anyone who's in this business to be responsible and be a steward of the environment. And that's what we plan to be.
Okay, and I'm sure there are federal and state laws or guidelines that you would have to follow in this manufacturing or production here in the states. Are you familiar with those?
Yes.
And, as I went through this, I was getting a little bit antsy.
Sure.
Environmental contaminants, we'll talk about asbestos and fillers and reinforcers.
We don't have any of that.
Formaldehyde, on and on. It's a list. Okay, it's a list. And then as I got to the end, you like this. It said that environmental insurance programs are offered by AIG. That made me feel really warm and fuzzy over that one. Do you have the insurance? And that, I guess that's where that would lead to. Do you have the insurance for environmental exposure if that were to happen?
Well, once we become a manufacturer of emulsions here in the state of North Carolina, we will be purchasing insurance, and it will cover a broad range of things that could happen with regard to emulsion manufacture, environmental situations included.
All right, Barbara, I don't want you to think I'm negative. I just started looking, and I was finding, and these were questions I felt like that needed to be asked.
Sure.
What about the safety of the employees? Because, in reading this, there can be explosions and so forth. And you said there are guidelines that you follow. Can you give us just a brief explanation about how you handle that as far as your plant is concerned and,
well, sure,
and the employees are
sure
concerned? Because I am concerned
with
about that.
With any type of manufacturer, you have to be concerned with safety. There's the type of safety you would be involved with any type of manufacturing facility. There's also additional process safety requirements that you have when you're making polymers, and we are quick to follow all federal guidelines with regard to safety. We're also quick to go beyond that and follow those prescribed by our industry.
And state, yeah.
Yeah, and state.
We don't want to forget that.
And local.
Okay. And local. Absolutely. Okay, I don't think I have any more questions, and thank you. But again, I'm trying to get you to educate us.
Well, sure.
I'm not being negative, and I don't want you to think that.
Okay.
Okay.
I don't. Okay.
Anybody got any questions?
What kind of skills are going to be required for the employees that you're going to hire?
Okay. Well, we're going to have more than one type of employee. There's obviously going to be manufacturing and shipping and receiving. And for that, we're looking for people who have good math comprehension, who can understand a little bit about chemistry, chemical environments, people to some extent who are willing to work on shift. There would be a modest amount of lifting, but it would be small quantity lifting. We also have requirements for people in the laboratory, so that would require a little bit more of an understanding of chemistry. And obviously there'll be some office and administrative as well.
Will you be transferring people from Germany here? Is that
No, we will not
plan?
Be. Well, with the exception of, we didn't transfer
except
him
for Sebastian.
From Germany. He was already over here. But we'll be bringing people over from Germany a little bit to help train people here, but we're not going to be relocating people here to work.
That's good.
What type of waste will this facility generate as far as water or any other type of...
You hit the nail right on the head. We will have wastewater. We intend to do everything within our means not to create any other substantial waste stream. But, for example, we'll be using gloves, filters, that sort of thing. If we ever were to have a product that went bad, that product could potentially become waste, although, frankly, with the parent company, that's not something they experience. But even if it were, it's a non-hazardous product, so it's not something that presents a difficulty to dispose of like you'd have with certain other types of manufacture.
How would you dispose of it?
How would you dispose of it? Well, there are, I'm not certain exactly in this location. That's something I'm still going to be pursuing, but you can incinerate it. You can find other avenues of reuse. Basically, you know, what we're talking about here is an emulsion polymer. It's something that would be much akin to the base of a paint latex or an adhesive. If you were to look at a jar of it, it would look a lot like Elmer's glue. So, you know, it's not something that's particularly difficult.
Is Jerry Peterman here, Mayor Peterman?
He is. Yeah, he's sitting right back there.
I can't see him. Mayor, it would be in the Graham water system, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, what's your opinion of what you're hearing?
Well, my opinion is these are professionals, and the questions you're asking relates to our water system, our wastewater system, and they have done their homework, and they know what they're talking about, and my city manager has looked into it, too. We can handle what they're asking for, or we wouldn't be looking at the business.
Just wanted to ask.
What other type of products or manufacturers are y'all going to need in conjunction with what y'all produce? Are you going to bring other manufacturers on into this area? If you choose this area, what other manufacturers would you expect to move here to support your?
Well, initially, we're going to build a facility. I don't know that we'll be bringing in other manufacturers, but we certainly are going to be needing engineering, electrical, survey, accounting, those types of construction people. We'll also need distribution help. So, you know, we need people to move raw materials in, product.
Well, I guess out. What I'm asking is how do y'all ship y'all's product? Do you ship it in a can or?
We would primarily ship the product in tank wagons, okay. So over the road trucks.
Okay.
But some of it will go out in tote bins, that's really the main options.
Okay. More questions?
Well, I think it's good. You're right here, right on the interstate.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
And the rail is here too, and of course there's the trucks for the interstate. So
very good place.
You're in a prime location.
Absolutely. We're very impressed with this location and excited about the possibility of being here.
And we have a lot of water.
Okay, well, that's
right,
important too.
Well, I noticed that, from what I was reading that you did need water.
You absolutely need water. It's emulsion is a water-based polymer, and it's typically half water. So, and that's why it makes a lot more sense to make it in North America than ship it from Europe, because it doesn't make sense to ship water.
Across the ocean. No, it does not.
Okay. No more questions? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the next, I think that's all we have on that one.
That's the additional public comments.
Yeah, any additional public comments?
Yes, I
see. Well, Henry, I don't know who.
Sorry.
Okay, Mr. Vines, come up front, please.
My name is Henry Vines from Snow Camp, North Carolina. Thank you, Madam Chairman and Commissioners. I have one question that I wanted to ask. In reading through the packet, there's going to be 10 jobs that are going to be initial between now and 2011, and then there'll be an additional 10 jobs between now and 2013. These additional 10 jobs, are they going to be based on the expansion of the businesses that you're talking about, or is it going to be, or 20 jobs going to be on capacity of your manufacturing?
Well, the 20 jobs will be what it takes to round out our business plan over that period of time. There would still be some additional capacity associated with the plant. We won't top out at that point in time.
But the other 10 jobs are not going to be based on whether or not y'all's business increase. If the 20 people will be to bring it to peak capacity of production that you're planning on right now.
the production that we're planning on right now for that period in time.
It's not based on increase in sales and stuff.
I just want it is based on the sales that will exist at that point in time.
Right.
But it's a number that we feel very comfortable with, that we're very certain about. And we have very real customers who we're supplying right now who were assuring us that that's what they want. This isn't business we have to create.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes. Mr. Chivers.
Commissioners, I'm going to oppose this incentive. Before I say my little bit, I think that Commissioner Sutton and Commissioner Vaughn brought up some very good points about the emissions and waste products this company would create and how the community is going to handle those products. Graham Wastewater, I think, when he said we could handle it, am I assuming correctly that you mean you can handle the volume of waste created by this company?
Yes, sir. Our city manager has worked with the chamber and with the company to make sure they would not be looking at Graham if we could not handle
the volume. Has the company provided you a list of chemicals that will have to go through Graham Wastewater?
Yes, sir.
And does the public have access to what those chemicals are?
The public has access to anything that's given to us at our city hall. Yes, sir. You can go down there and get anything that we have gotten related to this.
Because my understanding then is these chemicals that are basically flushed into Graham Wastewater then is treated at the plant and then spread out as sludge on the land. Is that not correct? Is that how you would dispose of these products?
We own a farm that we...
Correct. Do. So it goes out, it goes, it's spread on the land. Is that correct?
On our own property, yes, sir.
Well, I don't care whose property it is. It's spread on the land and there are landowners and community people that live around that property. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I think that the community needs more time to kind of look at these issues because sludge right now is an issue in this county and all counties actually in the United States that's coming about and we're just starting to get a handle, very small start on a handle as to what the effects or possible effects of these chemicals that are put onto the land and then washed off by the rains and then end up in streams and rivers and down on the coast and the ocean and so forth. So I don't know possibly I'm assuming the commissioners were prepared to make a decision tonight. And I'm going to oppose the incentive for the incentive's sake, but I'm also going to ask the commissioners give the public more information in order to understand what the waste and emissions ramifications might be for this plant in our community. So yes, the company is going to provide some jobs, a small amount of jobs actually, and in this economy, of course, jobs are good. I can't argue that. But we also need to know what it's going to cost the community. Is there going to be costs? And how is the rest of the community going to have to handle and pay for those costs that this company would create. So I would propose that commissioners postpone a decision tonight. In regards to incentives, I always find it interesting that business people that usually want to keep government out of their lives always find room for tax incentives to expand. And I'm trying to understand the asking here of $50,000 from the county and $50,000, I guess, from Graham, the $100,000 as opposed to a $5 million investment and as opposed to the size of this company. And the young man that spoke and said that the company finances all of its expansion out of its own cash flows is not quite correct because they're asking Alamance County and Graham to finance expansion with our cash flows. So, and given the size of this company, I believe 60 million euros was mentioned. I think that's like 120 million US, is that not right? Maybe
not
less? How much is a euro now? I'm sorry?
It's also sales.
It's sales,
right.
Okay. But I'm just judging by the size of this company, and saying, well, what's $100,000 or at least $50,000 in this case from the county going to do? I mean, this company comes here. I'm not sure if there was a site selection consultant or if this was all done in-house.
All in-house.
Okay. And I'm trying to understand, does the company need this? This is a successful company by their own admission. This is a company that is producing lots of cash flow, enough cash flow that it doesn't need bank loans. This is a company that has come here and looked at this site from business standpoint. The key business inputs is what they looked at. They looked at their markets, the closeness to their markets. They looked at transportation, labor. They're making this decision based on key business inputs, not on incentives. Now, there's a good book that is out. Greg Leroy wrote it called, now it's a very provocative title, and I don't mean any disrespect, but it's called The Great American Job Scam, which is designed to sell books. But Mr. Leroy makes some very good points in here, and you should all, maybe for future reference, try to get a hold of the copy of it. But there is a chapter called Site Location 101, How Companies Decide Where to Expand or Relocate. And I'm not going to go through much of this except to read this quote that is in the book by Paul O'Neill, which is a former CEO of Alcoa and President W. Bush's first Secretary of the Treasury. And he says, as a businessman, I never made an investment decision based on the tax code. If you are giving money away, I will take it. If you want to give me inducements for something I am going to do anyway, I will take it. But good business people do not do things because of inducements. They do it because they can see that they are going to be able to earn the cost of capital out of their own intelligence and organization of resources. This is $50,000 from the county. If this is a good place to locate from a business standpoint, $50,000 on a $5 million investment in the size of this company is not going to make a bit of difference. So I would urge that that you first of all postpone a decision tonight to give the public greater input on the effects of any environmental effects in this company, and also I would oppose it, oppose the incentive outright. Thank you very much.
Any more comments? If not, we'll close that public hearing. Do we want to go ahead and make a motion on this, Mr. Honeycutt? Put them all together.
Is it okay if I just speak a little bit to
sure.
What was just said?
Sure.
I don't want to create a
sure.
Well, now I'm a little perplexed. I felt like it would be an extremely good thing here to come here today to share with you the fact that we have been economically very successful. I don't think it's the case that you would prefer that we came here with a weak economic position and would talk in terms of potential grants. Now, I will say we've gone to great lengths to work out a program where we're talking in terms of grants based on performance. If we provide a certain level of economic activity, we get a grant after we've been here for that period of time, after we have created those jobs. And, I'm surprised that wouldn't be a pleasant story. I think it is a pleasant story. And with regard to the quote, I do think we are good businessmen. We're competent to create a business that's sound. As I mentioned, we did exhaustive research. We looked any number of places. We are coming here for a whole host of reasons. And I can tell you that the potential for recouping some money over time in the form of a grant, once we have performed according to our promises, and only if we've performed according to our promises, is a part of that. But I will agree with the gentleman. There are other reasons for us to be here, too. We're not here just seeking incentives. We're here because you have a good community, and we hope that we can work with you.
Okay.
Let me say that I believe that this company is going to do Alamance County a good deed to come here, and we hope you choose Alamance County because that's going to increase the value of the property that they're going to locate in. It's going to bring incentives for other companies to locate here. It's just a good business sense to invite companies from Europe to here. We're glad you chose the United States, and we hope you'll choose Alamance County to locate. And I'll make the motion that
before
we...
Before you do, can I say something?
Go ahead.
I haven't experienced working with people from Germany. There is a strong work ethic. And I am tickled to death that you are looking to come here. I know that work ethic. But let me say this, and I have it written down so that nobody misunderstands. The funding for the assistance will come from property taxes, which will be generated by the industry over a two-year period following completion of construction in a sum greater than the amount of the proposed assistance.
That's correct.
No tax increase is contemplated due to this offer of assistance to the industry. So make your motion, Bill.
I'll make the motion that we accept this company and we invite them here and give them incentives to do so.
And I'll second it.
Okay, before we vote, let me make a comment here. I was just going to vote no and not really say a whole lot. First of all, I don't vote for cash incentives. I just don't do it. I have in the past. But I've stopped. I'm not going to vote for cash ever again for anybody. LabCorp, I voted against it. Kaiser Roth, I voted against it. Other companies, I've voted no. I don't have a problem with infrastructure that is available to where other companies, not only, say, for instance, your company, but another company could hook up to it as well and benefit everybody. I mean, I had a state legislator. I mean, it's not that anybody's trying to put your company down at all. Trust me, okay? There's a massive debate in this country and in this state about actually giving cash incentives. It's not that they're trying to slander a company, but it's just the fact that there are other companies that come to our county and or other areas in the state and nation, and they don't ask for incentives, a lot of them. They go because there's water, there's cheap labor, there's good transportation, and so forth and so on. And I personally believe we have those things here. We have a finite county as far as square miles. We have two interstates running through our front or backyard, ever how you want to classify that. We've got all the water somebody could want. We have a lot of non-union labor, cheap labor, and a lot of companies are coming from Europe because of the labor cost. Instead of paying $25 and $30 an hour in Germany or some other countries, they're coming over here so they can pay $15 and so forth and so on. I'm not saying that's your company. But it's not a personal slander against any company. Trust me, it's not with me. It's just my father was with Burlington Industries for, oh Lord, close to 50 years, 40-some for sure. And we moved all over the Southeast, and I can't even comprehend that Burlington Industries would have ever asked for cash to locate in a particular community. And again, it is a check in check form, but it's cash. And I actually had a state senator meet with me for a couple of hours here in this building here not too long ago, and he told me he had no idea that was even done. And we went in the back room and got a check that was made out to a particular business. So it's not a personal thing. It's just a philosophical issue with me. Others obviously feel different, but I welcome you here. If it's approved and you come here, good luck to you. But it has nothing to do with challenging anybody's integrity or anything. It's just the mere fact that our water, our people, our labor, our transportation, everything, location, wasn't good enough. And that's what the issue is with me. So.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. All in favor of accepting this agreement with Indolore America, please say
I have
four eyes.
You have one no.
One no. So we hope you will come here and we welcome you here.
Thank you.
As long as we all go to Germany. Just kidding. Okay. The next thing is the construction contracts that we have. And Mr. Burgess, are you?
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. have tonight, we have Lucian Routon with Routon Nicholson and DeLuca Architects, who's the lead architect on the facility improvement plan project, and also Stuart Keeler, who's our purchasing director here. Also, they're available to answer any questions that you may have. As going back to July 7, 2008, the board approved for us to move forward with the renovations and repairs to several several county facilities that were in need of repair. At that same meeting, the board approved for us to enter an agreement with the architectural firm that I mentioned earlier. On September 2nd, the board approved the contract with the architectural firm. The board was given updates of this project on December the 1st, 2008, and May the 4th of 2009. Once the board approved the contract with the architectural firm, they then began their design phase of the project. That took about 9 months working with us and staff, and then their engineers also, to try to design the facilities that you'll hopefully be approving this evening. Once that design process was completed, then we entered the bidding phase. And I want to talk a little bit about what we did to try to notify companies as far as that we were taking, that we were in the process of accepting bids for this project. Probably the first notification that companies got was probably through the media. Once we came and presented this project, even beginning back in July of 2008, the word kind of got out into the community that these would be repairing these facilities. So some of the contractors probably soon after that started making some inquiries, either calling or just running into some of staff and asking what was going on here. We tried to keep track of those, referred those questions to the architect so that they could start a bidding list of potential companies or contractors that would be available to do these projects. We also went through several things. Let me just give you a list of those so that you'll know the efforts that were made to get the word out that these projects would be forthcoming. Of course, as I mentioned, we developed a bidders list, sent out notices to bidders and scope of work to a regional plan room, which is a location, and there's several of these out there. I don't know much about them. Stuart can give you a little bit more detail about that. But that's a location where contractors can go to find out about projects, not only ours, but other projects throughout the state that are available for bidding on. So they were notified. Also, the project notification was sent to the historically underutilized business, which is the hub office in Raleigh. Advertisements was made in the local newspaper. We did contact some specialty contractors that would be doing some scope of the work to let them know that these projects would be forthcoming and that for their opportunities to bid. We did receive phone calls. We followed up on those phone calls, did refer them to the architect so that they could get on their bidding list. We also encouraged and referred, as I mentioned, contractors to R&D. We briefed potential bidders at a pre-bid conference of upcoming projects and provided information to them in a brochure that the county provides on how to bid projects in Alamance County. And the last thing was that we did make contact with the local Chamber of Commerce and the Alamance Casual Home Builders Association to promote the awareness of current and upcoming Alamance County projects. So we feel like we got the word out there. By statute, all that we're really required to do is to run an ad in the paper. But we wanted to get the word out there because the better we can get the word out there, the more companies we get bidding on the project, and hopefully the better prices that we would get from the bidding process. Once that process was completed, then the bids were sent out, bids came back in, the request for bids came back in. And if you look on your exhibit, you've got a exhibit here which is listed at the top as Exhibit A. That lists all of the projects, the eight projects that I'll be covering tonight that we'll be asking you to award the contracts on. Once the bids came back in, the architectural firm reviewed those bids and evaluated them to make sure that the bid went to the lowest responsible bidder. By state statute, we're required to award the bids to the lowest responsible bidder. The lowest part's the easiest thing. What's the lowest price that came in? The responsible part, the definition of that is that responsible refers to the bidder's capacity to perform the contract, looking at their experience, their training, and the quality of personnel and their financial strength. So once those bids came back in, the architect looked at the company that had the lowest bid to see whether they were really able to perform the job. Once they made that determination, they sent a recommendation letter over. You have that in your packet also. Attached to the, and that's Exhibit C, I believe, in your packet. Attached to those recommendation letters is also a bid list of all of the companies that bid and what their quotes were and where their location was. Let me give you a quick run-through of how many companies bid on each of these projects and whether or not they were located in Alamance County. The first project was the Human Services Center Chiller Project, replacement project. We received four bids on those. None of those were from Alamance County. The Family Justice Center Fire Marshal's Office project, we received 16 bids. Two of those were from Alamance County. The office, County Office Building Court Annex project, we received 10 bids. Two of those were Alamance County companies. The Maintenance Building Renovation project, we received 8 bids. One of those was an Alamance County company. The Criminal Courts Renovation project, we received 6 bids. Two of those were an Alamance County company. The Roof Bundle, we received 4 bids. None of those were Alamance County companies. And the last, the Paving Bundle, we received 11 bids, and 4 of those was Alamance County companies. Now, you've also listed on there, you'll see the County Office Building and Court Annex Generator project. The board had already approved the purchase of that generator and the installation of that generator at previous meeting. What we're looking at in this project is actually the architectural work and the engineering work that was done on that project, which will be the only thing that's being paid for out of this loan tonight. That's the process we went through as far as receiving the bids. We're trying to even improve on that as we go into the next phases of these projects so that we can even get the word out better. So we're working on that.
Yeah, that was my concern. Really.
Yes, ma'am. And y'all, the board had mentioned that several meetings ago, and at that point, and we'd had some previous discussions of that, but I did get in touch with the architecture and reemphasize the importance of making sure that the word got out to the local community. Now, there may have been more local contractors that actually contacted the architect, but for whatever reason decided not to bid on these projects, either because they didn't have their company was not of the size to be able to do projects these big, or for other reasons they decided not to bid on it. So the word seemed to have gotten out there, but we're even going to try to work on that better. Now, if you look again at this this exhibit here, the long one here, the colorful one, that lists, again, all of the projects that we're looking at doing. It tells the name of the project. It tells the scope of work that's going to be done. It tells the construction contract amount. It tells the contingency. It tells the architectural fees. It tells some costs that we as a county will incur that are owner's reserve costs. And then it tells you the total cost of the project. Let me run through these very quickly as far as the costs go. And this is what we'll be asking you to approve tonight. The Human Services Center Chiller Replacement Project, total cost of that project is $239,905.63. The Family Justice Center Fire Marshal's Office project is $1,340,975.53. The County Office Building Court Annex project is $462,714.43. The County Office Building Court Annex Generator project, as I mentioned earlier, the purchase of that's being handled, was previously approved by y'all. That's being paid out of other funds other than this loan. The installation is being paid for out other sources other than this loan. What you'll be paying for here, which is $30,438.29, is the design fees. The maintenance building renovation, $242,803.55. Criminal courts renovation, $195,840.53. The roof bundle, $483,135.96. And the paving bundle, $315,154.50. And then the county has requested an additional contingency of $189,031.58, which brings us a total of $3,500,000. Now, any of that contingent is not used, it will be carried over to the next group of projects. So the money won't be wasted, it will just be carried over. But that gives us some cushion in case some unexpected things occur in the project. Once we received those bids in, we had to find out who we could borrow the money from. We sent out emailed RFPs, requests for proposals, to 15 lenders that had a presence in Alamance County. Of those 15, we received 6 proposals back. Tonight we'll be asking you to approve a financing agreement with the Bank of America. And I'll go into the details of that a little bit later. There's 2 resolutions that you have in your packet. One is resolution Exhibit A, and that is a awarding financing agreement in Group A construction contracts for the facilities improvement plan as authorized by North Carolina General Statute Sections 160A-20 and Section 143-129. I want to just go through to the end of that resolution. There are some findings of fact that we would like for the board to agree to this evening, but let me list the 4 things that the board would be approving through that adoption of that resolution. First thing is authorization would be given for the county to enter into a financing agreement with Bank of America for a $3,500,000 loan with a 10-year repayment period and an interest rate of 4.061%. As I mentioned earlier, these funds would be used for the Group A projects. Any funds that are remaining would be transferred over to the next group of projects that we're looking at doing. The second thing is authorization would be given for the county to award construction contracts in accordance with This sheet that you have here and the dollar amounts that I mentioned are that appear on here as far as the construction contracts, including their contingency. The third, and of course, these construction contracts are subject or conditional upon receiving local government commission approval and securing the bank, the proceeds from the bank loan. Third thing is the county manager shall have the authority to execute any agreements which are necessary in order to carry out the intentions of this resolution, including but not limited to construction contracts, finance agreement, et cetera. And the fourth and final approval that we'd be requesting under that resolution is that the county manager have the authority to use his discretion and make modifications where necessary when executing the construction contracts and finance agreement as authorized by this resolution, so long as it does not exceed the total cost of the $3,500,000. We're asking you to adopt that resolution tonight. The second resolution is one that is required by the local government commission. That is listed in your packet as Exhibit D. That authorizes the filing of an application for approval of a financing agreement as authorized by North Carolina General Statute 16820. There is a set of findings of fact that if you approve the resolution, you will be approving those findings of fact also. I did want to bring you to your attention number five under findings of fact, because I think this is one of the more important findings, is that the increases in taxes necessary to meet the sums to fall due under both this financing agreement contract, the $3,500,000, and the remaining $6,500,000 that gets us up to the $10 million projects, that all of these contracts together will be no more than 1 cent per $100 valuation. So just need to be aware of that, that is what the total debt payment each year will require a penny of our tax rate or somewhat under that. So just want to make you aware of that.
Okay.
If you do approve that resolution, you will be authorizing the manager act on behalf of the county of Alamance and filing an application with the North Carolina Local Government Commission for approval of the project and the proposed financing contract and other actions not inconsistent with the resolution. If you approve this to move forward tonight, we hope to have these projects underway around October the 1st, give or take a week or two either way, is when we will begin these projects. We'll talk to you about just a few other things very quickly. There has been some questions about federal stimulus money. The problem that we've had up to this point is I think not a lot of the federal stimulus money has been released as a total of the whole amount that's been appropriated. Most of what's been released at this point has been for utility infrastructure work, for roads and those types of things, not for really what would fit our needs as far as these projects go. I confirmed that with our COG, with the person at our local COG that actually handles the federal stimulus issues. He confirmed that that's been the case up to this point. However, there will be some money available for energy efficiency issues. So as we move into the next group of projects, we'll be looking at some availability of those funds possibly, which if we can get our hands on some of those, then it would cause us not to have to borrow as much money. But we'll see how all that goes. Last thing, the Group B projects. We're looking at those coming back to the board for board to approve what you're basically approving tonight for Group A projects, for Group B projects around February the 1st, with those projects to start sometime around probably the middle of March. We'll come back with Group B projects. There may be a second group of Group B projects or a Group C projects, depending on the logistics and timing of some of these projects. So that's where we are tonight. We would ask, if you've got any questions, be glad to take those after you finish the public hearing part, if the board would be so kind to adopt those two resolutions, and then we would be able to move forward with these projects.
Oh, I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
About the 1 cent tax increase. Now, yes, are you saying that's going to be every year?
No, that's just a one-time.
Okay,
total,
don't scare me like that.
Right. Now, it wouldn't be over the next 10 years raising it a penny every year. It would be an initial 1 cent tax increase to cover that 10-year period of time, because the 1 cent, generates about $1.25 million in revenue. And so the repayment for the debt service on $10 million would fall below that amount. So the most that taxes would have to be raised to cover that would be 1 cent.
Okay, because that was my concern.
Yes,
and I like the interest rate at the 4.061.
Yes, ma'am. And it was good that we could get it down to a 10-year repayment period. I think you had mentioned, Commissioner Sutton, about trying to get some more. When we had originally talked, we were looking at either 15 or 20 years, and you had mentioned about that. And so we got numbers on 10, 15, and 20.
Yeah, I saw
that. And we tried to get, and I think the quicker we can get this paid off, the better.
Yeah, I agree. Any other questions?
I had just one for Lucian, I guess, on the re-roofing bid. Why was the second one chosen instead of the lowest bid on that?
on the re-roofing roof.
Yes, sir.
I think that was it.
Yeah. And what was that question?
Why was the firm that got that awarded as opposed to the lowest bid?
Let me get
that. I've got an answer to that.
Okay.
The one that had the lowest bid did not have a license to operate in North Carolina.
Very good.
All we need to know.
That kind of threw him out.
Yeah.
We're trying to rule out those that didn't have licenses. So that's,
and that was, is that that's not exactly something right. We get on the preliminary bid process?
Well, the test, acid test, is when they present their bids, they have to get bonds, and they declare a license. And at that point, once we get the bids, we check the licenses. That's part of what we do. And before we validate the bid tab, is to be sure it's a valid contractor license. It turned out it was really a sham.
Oh, okay.
So yeah, they had a contractor's license number, but it wasn't valid. So
right.
Well, it was very upsetting that only one Alamance County group got a contract.
I think that was on the paving.
The paving, yes. And that was very upsetting to me when I looked at all of these, and the rest of them were from Durham or Kernersville or Raleigh or Greensboro or wherever. Well,
there were two projects, not just one.
Huh.
So, and again.
And I think we need to get in the next one. Please try to get it out to in a different manner, if it's on the website
one thing we're looking at.
And I know it's hard to do that.
It is. I mean, we press harder than we normally do on any kind of state project. Usually the contractors that are interested in this kind of work, they know where to go. They come after the work.
They get in line, don't they?
They get in line. And we had on one of the projects, a local engineer, electrical contractor came to the pre-bid and said, no, I don't want to do that job. And so it went to a firm in Durham that said, yes, I do want to do that job. And both of them were equally qualified to do it. One just, for no reason that we could think of, just said, no, I don't want to do it. They must have a lot of work.
They must.
Well, just for information purpose, tomorrow I think Stuart's going to the local home builders to talk with anybody that's interested, as far as contractors and so forth, on bidding on our work. So.
And then he's also going to meet with the chamber the next day also to try to get the word out to them. And then we're also looking at, I know it's kind of hard to see from here, but the architectural firm has come up with a spreadsheet that we'll actually put on our webpage, have a link to it. We're looking at something, maybe this or something similar, that basically lists the upcoming projects, the dates that they need to be concerned about and all of that. So if they go on there, they'll actually see all of the upcoming Group B projects, so they'll have an opportunity to make sure they get their bids in time.
That's going to be on the county's web page.
Yes, sir. That's correct.
Yeah, that's good.
Too. Once they're noticed, we're trying to establish a web-based R&D plan room. I mean, R&D meaning our firm. Like the plan rooms that are already in existence. But what this would do is if anyone goes to the site, sniffs around, we can keep a record of who it was, even if they stayed for a minute or 20 minutes, if they got drawings, if they paid, if they looked at the drawings, if they sent them on. You know, it completely captures all the activity so that you all can see it. And you can see who's looking at it, who's interested in the work, who carries it out, and who doesn't. So it's just one more step we're trying to take. And it'll also improve access to the bid documents. So it's not such a arduous thing. But most of the people that are doing this work, they know how to do this process. And honestly, you want people like that doing the work. You don't want just some Johnny-come-lately, you know, doing something that you're spending $4 or $5 million on. It's got to be a qualified contractor. So I mean, some of this work's very complex, and you know, we want to have a qualified contractor.
Well, I'll add, you know, we have said so many times from up here that we're never possible have Alamance County people doing the work.
I understand.
And like Linda, I just felt there was not due diligence in trying to get that word out to our folks. That Durham knew about it, Greensboro knew about it, Kernersville and Liberty, everybody knew about it except our folks. You know, sitting on the other side, now you're out there doing it. I am glad to see that you have that prepared and you'll get that out on the website.
Oh yeah.
Maybe through the chamber, maybe through the home builders. Get this information out. Thank you.
What was the original package? I thought that was $10 million.
It was, and the rest of the projects we have yet to complete, courthouse renovation, some roofing projects, some other things, paving projects, that will get us up to the $10 million. So that'll be the next Group B projects, or and there could possibly, if we don't have all design work done in that time, there, or timing issues, it may be a Group C project, but that will get us up to the $10 million.
Okay, forgive me. I'm just getting old. And
that's what you're talking about in February.
A lot of things just skip over this bald head. But, okay.
Like a ski soap.
He's talking about that in February.
Okay, well, I've got a question. Okay, we're borrowing $3.5 million, right?
That's correct.
Okay, well, how are we going to finance the other?
The other will be part of that 1 cent that I talked about. All of that will be, we'll go and borrow the other, and that will actually, we'll come back to the board on February the 1st. To ask you to approve the same types of things that you approved tonight for the Group B projects. So that'll be done in February. That should be the remainder of those facility improvement plan projects, or almost all of them. We've got some timing issues where we may have to carry some of those over to a Group C project, but all of those together will equal the $10 million that we approved.
So no more tax increases? Or
that'll be that 1 cent that we're talking, 1 cent we're talking about.
Just a one-time 1 cent.
Correct. I don't remember us really. I know you got to pay it back, and you know, where are you going to get it from? But I don't remember when we talked about the $10 million and we talked about tax increases to cover it. But
I thought we, at that particular time, I thought we had said something was coming off of the.
That was with the 800 megahertz project. Mm-hmm. When we borrowed the $4.65 million on that one, I think that was the one that we were able to use the loan that we were paying off to help make some of that payment. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So that was on the 800 megahertz project. That's correct.
Any more questions?
Yeah, I got a question about the, I don't know how many of you got it. I got it and I've lost it. It's either here or South Carolina one. The DVD that they sent us about the plaster, about the courthouse, right, without mentioning names.
Right.
Here, what's the concern? Have you seen this DVD? Or I didn't see it. I meant to watch it and I left it and never did see it.
I don't know that there's anything that is outside of the realm of, I have not seen it. The project architect in our office has seen it. But the report I've been given is that it's something that we've got, whatever it is, it can be handled within the budget that we've got assigned to the project.
You're talking about all the water and everything?
No, I don't even know what it was. I mean,
oh, okay.
Somebody.
Well, there are issues of where water's gotten in. I mean, we've got other issues. Yeah. Daily that crop up on that project that we're trying to stamp down, you know, that
because nothing's been done to that inside of that building.
Easy, and frankly, exactly. It wasn't built the way it was said it was built. Yeah. So we've got some issues that we're struggling with, but we've got, you know, expertise to resolve them, and hopefully we'll get them resolved.
Isn't that where we talked about the windows, whether we replaced them or all that kind of stuff? We got that?
We've got now some structural issues we're trying to, that we've uncovered that have been there forever that, unfortunately, now that we know about them, we're going to have to deal with them.
Right.
But I don't think it won't be a budget buster. Okay. I mean, we've done a great deal to the Offutt County Courthouse to bring it back into the administration considers a reasonable expense for that building for the purpose it needs to serve. And the money that we cut out of it was money that really was never intended, you know, it was never really intended to be a full renovation of the whole building of all the offices. It was just the areas that needed help. And nevertheless, we've been very diligent in looking at the exterior, the mold, the structural issues, all sorts of issues that, besides the fact that we want to, you know, carry out, and now that we want to carry out possibly this function in that building too, okay, wasn't part of it. So there's just a lot of things that we're having to fold into this budget, and I think, you know, I'm pretty confident we can make them all come out.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
At what point did we decide that we need to have a 1 cent tax increase? Because myself, like Tim, I don't remember in the beginning that we said that we would need to increase taxes.
We did discuss it at the budget presentation
And we talked about a revenue neutral tax rate that I mentioned as part of the presentation, that with our new debt service, that we will be able to cover the payments. I think we have about one quarter in this year's budget. However, for the 9-10, 10-11 fiscal year, that we would, I think it's anywhere from a penny or 0.75 cents up to a penny is what we're looking at as far as just covering debt service.
Because this year's payment that we'll make in this budget year on this loan, we've got the money budgeted to cover that without increasing the taxes.
Right.
If I could clarify an answer that I gave to Mr. Sutton, there are some other projects that will be outside of this $10 million, and we're going to be coming to you at a future meeting, next meeting, on the Pleasant Grove issue and also the Eli Whitney facility, which are similar projects, those two, Pleasant Grove and Eli Whitney. Eli Whitney currently is in this $10 million. We'll be talking to you about the possibility of pulling that out, and those be standalone projects. So I just want to make sure I'm clarifying that. Also, one of the projects that is in this $10 million that we have found a way possibly, because we are to renovate a facility that's in this next group of projects, where we're leasing space now for occupants in another building. We possibly can renovate that building, put them in this facility, and then no longer have any lease payments to make, and we can use that money to pay the debt service. So I did want to further expand on my answer to you, because there are some other projects out there that are outside of the $10 million that you're going to hear about in the future. So I did want to let you know those would be coming before you.
Penny on the tax rates, how much?
$1.2 million, I believe.
1.2.
And when we originally started on these projects, the $10 million was up at close to $15 million, and we had to bring it back down. So there's not that we're coming back and asking you to go up to $15 million, but there were other needs that we wanted to stay at $10 million. So,
well, I'm going to vote against the tax increase situation. I don't believe our budget's as tight as it can be, and to have to raise taxes to pay for repairs is.
That's not on here tonight.
Are we not voting for a resolution that would say we're voting, agreeing to it?
Well, no. What that would happen is when the budget's prepared for next year, then the budget at that time will be looking at what our revenues are coming in and what our expenses are with this new debt.
That's not on here.
But, isn't there a resolution saying that we're approving that, though?
There's a resolution that says a findings of fact that all of these projects together will be equivalent to no more than 1 cent of the tax rate. Now, from a budgeting standpoint, there is a possibility that when next year's budget's prepared or the year after, that there has to be a 1 cent tax increase to cover all of this new debt service. There is also a possibility that some of it can be paid by other revenue sources as a worst case.
Where's the resolution statement about
it's Exhibit D.
Tax.
It's Exhibit D.
It states it in the resolution about the 1%.
Yeah, it does.
It does.
Future phase.
I'm not going to vote for whatever.
Can you read it?
More than 1% or 100%.
Yes, sir. Number five, it says that under the existing plan, which is the overall $10 million plan, this project is the first phase of potentially several phases of repairs and renovations to county facilities. The increase in taxes necessary to meet the sums to fall due under the proposed contract, as well as the contracts for future phases under the existing plan, will be no more than 1 cent. It's not going to exceed 1 cent. Now, depending on how the budget goes, it could be less than a penny, depending on if there are other revenue sources available to cover part of the debt service. But we have the local government commission wants a worst case scenario to make sure that the board's aware of it, to make sure that if budget wise if we have to increase taxes up to a penny, that the board has been made fully aware of that as they approve us to borrow this money and to request their approval. Now, will we have to raise taxes one penny? We will not know until we get into that particular budget year and we're putting the budget together as to how much, what our revenues are, what our total expenditures are, and whether or not taxes have to be raised at that time. But there is a potential, but it will be no more than a penny if taxes had to be raised. Tonight, you're really not, and Craig, you may want to clarify this, but you're really not voting to raise taxes by a penny, but you're kind of putting everybody on notice, including the board's people on notice, the possibility of that. That will be addressed in a future budget. Now, when that budget comes up, if the board doesn't want to raise the taxes by a penny, then they can cut, the board can elect to cut other things out and get it down to, that's your option at that time. So.
Okay.
So at this time, I'm asking for a motion to accept the construction contracts, the financing agreement, and the local government commission applications.
And if you approve the two resolutions, you will have, in effect, have done that. That's correct.
Where's the resolution that I got to vote against?
Okay, the resolution, okay, the first resolution, which is Exhibit A.
Well, put me down for no for that one.
No, that's the one that doesn't mention the tax increase. Resolution Exhibit A basically awards the financing agreement and the construction contracts, and then also gives the manager the authority to execute documents related to all of this. That's Exhibit A. That's the first resolution. The second resolution is the one that is filed, the finance agreement, filed the application with the local government commission. That's the one, Exhibit D, that does mention the potential 1 cent tax.
And which one is that on here? Three, or do I need to do them separately?
Yeah, please.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
The construction contracts. Can we break
okay.
that out first?
Yes, sir. And that would be the resolution awarding financing agreement and construction A, Group A construction contracts for the facilities improvement plan. That is listed as Exhibit A in your agenda packet.
And that'll cover one and two.
That'll cover one and two. All right. At this time, I'll entertain a motion to approve numbers one and two.
For you, we have somebody who wants to ask a question.
Is this a public hearing?
Yes.
Yes.
You want to come up here to the...
Yeah, Jennifer.
About Graham's issue, but you say taxes. I perk up. I pay a lot of taxes here in Graham. And if you're getting a 4% loan, would it not seem reasonable if you're going to possibly have to raise taxes to just get a longer loan so that in the event that the economy comes back, you can pay back earlier, but you wouldn't necessarily be required to pay back earlier, which could actually result in a tax increase? If you got 4%,
we got that information.
Didn't you get a 15-year or 20-year? And if you had the money, you could pay it back early. And if you didn't, you wouldn't have to raise taxes.
Sounds reasonable.
We got that information on here.
Government don't think along those lines,
well,
Jennifer.
I mean, 4% is a great rate. You need to, you know, leverage the bank's money and not leverage the taxpayers' money.
Right.
It's my
but that was a 4% at that specific time. If you went out 15 years, it was 4.588.
Yeah, it was
still great. I mean, when you're looking at having to ask the taxpayers to come up with the money, and if the economy comes back or you cut out other things in your budget, you can pay it back early, but you just wouldn't be required to pay it back
early.
Yeah,
we've already approved that one.
Yeah, that
one. We've already approved that one. That one's passed.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Did they tell you that there was going to be a tax increase before you voted on that?
No.
That's
well, I guess.
And it's no definite that there is a tax increase.
Right. It's no definite here.
This has got to go through the budget process next year before that tax increase would
and
take
with the,
effect.
And
I mean, there are other
evaluation,
places
it's not
going to
be easy.
Taxes.
Just
and we put off working on these buildings for a long time. And
I'm for renovating the buildings. I'm just saying, what's the rush in paying the loan back at the expense of the taxpayers? I mean, why can't we just get a longer loan?
Yeah, we've already approved that one.
Yep.
You can
unapprove.
Vote. You can unapprove and decide to vote any way that you want to.
I understand. not on this one tonight.
Let me clarify. If on Exhibit B, that is the proposals that we receive from the lending institutions. If you do go out to 15 years, your interest rate does go up.
Right.
So you're going to pay more in interest. Even over the 10-year period of time, you're still going to pay more interest. That's why we're trying to shorten it down so we wouldn't pay as much interest to the banks.
All right.
Exactly.
Supposing that we did stretch it out to the 10-year, how much of an interest?
15-year?
Or 15-year. What are we looking at on an increase?
Okay. Down there under the third line under each category, if you look at Bank of America, for instance.
Which one are you on?
Exhibit B.
B.
Exhibit
okay.
B is in bold.
I didn't
Exhibit B.
Hold on a minute.
That's
the
sheet looks like this.
Yeah, I got it in one of these. I thought we were through with that one. I folded it up. It's not that one. Go ahead. I'm moving
okay,
there
you go.
There we
go. If you look under number three there, Lender Bank of America, which is the one we're proposing.
Right, 4.86.
Yes, ma'am. At the 10-year, which is the first section there, total interest paid over life alone is $796,000. If you extend it out to 15 years, the interest rate goes from 4.061% up to 4.588%. Over the life of the loan, then, you would pay $1,384,232.50 in interest. So over time, you would pay that much more. Now, I didn't run the numbers to see, okay, if we paid it off at the 10-year point, assuming we'd financed it for 15, but we paid off at the 10, how much more interest would we pay above the $796,000 that you would have paid with a 10-year loan?
At 4.588.
At 4.061%, how much more would you pay at 4.588%? I did not run those
numbers. Exactly.
But it would pay more even in that first 10 years.
Right.
If you did that. Regarding Exhibit A, that resolution, I don't know that the board took action to adopt that.
That's part of this proposal.
I thought somebody mentioned it.
I did. I thought we'd already done that.
So we've got to approve that now.
Okay. We're back to any more comments?
I don't know if there were other comments.
Yeah, I got one.
There's somebody behind.
Madam Chairman, County Commissioners, my problem with this whole thing is $10 million. I mean, you know, this is a lot of money. We don't have just an endless run of money in Alamance County. And number one, if you want to give jobs to contractors here in Alamance County, why did you go outside to get an architect? We're paying him over $500,000 to look after these projects. What is our maintenance crew doing? Why can't they do something? What's our inspections department doing? Let them take part in it. We need more local involvement in this. If I was sitting up there, there's no way I'd vote for this.
Lash, $10 million, this is what we've tried to do, and this is what we've been saying from the very beginning, but when you put things out for bid, they're laws.
How'd we get the architect from Durham? Why didn't we get one from Alamance County?
That was a competitive thing that was voted on last year, I think. Yeah.
Do what?
We have an office right here.
Yeah, but you're from Durham. Yeah, you relocated in Alamance County.
And it was a proven product that, you know, he had done work on the EMS building.
It may have been. But we're not an endless funding here.
But don't interrupt.
Well, he's got the floor.
Yeah, but I was trying to explain. So now he can have the floor.
We don't have endless funding.
We know.
The folks in Alamance County are running tight right now. And to spend $10 million, and Pleasant Grove has been sitting there for almost 2 years, let's do something to help those folks. Let's get our maintenance crew to see what we can do. You don't need an engineer, an architect to put a roof on.
I have a comment, too, about the fact that our courthouse has not been renovated in years, and there is where the problem started. It's been, when I became elected in 1990 as Hall River, as just one of the board members on the Hall River board, that courthouse is today exactly like it was in 1990, and nothing has been done to it. So, and how many years is that? Almost 20 years that only the outside of the courthouse has been renovated somewhat. So the inside has been totally left like it has been for probably more than 20 years. That's just the first time I was ever in that courtroom, and I think the same seats are still in it now that are horrible. I mean, you're afraid you're going to go through them or fall out of them or whatever. And so this is why it's costing so much now. Think about if they'd have done this over, which is hindsight is 2020, and I know that. But if this project had been worked on in the past 20 years and they had done something every year to this, we would not be in this predicament that now it's going to cost us $10 million now to get all this stuff renovated and get it up to par like it should be. And that's the problem that I see. Now, I don't know what everybody else thinks, but that's what I see.
When this first came up, several of us raised Cain about it, that these projects had been put off, and nothing done about it. And now we're at the point that something drastically needs to be done about it, or we lose the buildings. And that we don't want to happen.
Well, no disrespect to anybody, but you're not talking only about the courthouse.
I understand.
The Family Resource Center. You can't tell me that we don't have people in the maintenance department that can do that work now, man. I just don't agree with spending $10 million and not looking at it more carefully than we're looking at it.
Okay. Thank you, Lance. Mr. Vines?
Madam Chairman, I'm Henry Vines. I wanted to ask a question that y'all could look over and maybe ask the architect on this here. I looked over those bids, and most of those bids came in within a certain range. And the low bid come in, some of them as low as $40,000. Now, I can understand each one of these, you know, going to the lowest bidder, but when you have that much of a variation in bids, I want to be sure that we're going to get what we are getting and that we don't end up in a situation
that's why we got architects.
Yeah.
They will make sure that we get what we pay for.
Right.
That's why you hire our architects.
Right, I understand that. But I understand, too, that when we, you know, we was in the jail deal, we had one, too. And a lot of the stuff was underbid, and that's what my concern is on some of these. When all these bids, there's 10 bids on there, and all of them within 10 to 15, 10 to 12,000 each, and one drops to 40, it makes you concerned that is the quality going to be there? Is the materials going to be there? And I just want to be sure that we're going to get this and don't just take the low bid and get and come up 2-3 months
that's
later and say
qualified.
And then come back 2-3 months later and say, well, we got to have another $20,000 because we underbid too much. And appreciate
it. Example, we took bids on repairing some work at the HSC, that ambulatory building that's on the north end of the building that has the round corners. We took bids. One bid was $85,000. Another bid was $140,000. We decided to not use either of those bids because we realized the guy who did the low bid had left something off, and rather than take it and run him into the ground, we said, you know, there's no point in doing this. It's going to hurt you. It costs you a lot of money to fire a contractor, to get his surety to perform, because that never happens, despite the fact that that's what they're in business for. And we're going to rebid it. And the same guy may get it. And unfortunately, now the cat's out of the bag in terms of the cost. But, you know, it just wasn't fair for the county. And if anything, our fee, we suggested doing that. We would have made more money if we'd said, take the $140,000, because our fee goes up and down as a percentage based on what the bid cost is. We said, don't do that. You're getting a bad deal if you do that. So we're going to rebid it. It's going to cost us a lot of money to rebid it. Maybe the low bid will be $90,000 or $95,000. At least that's, you know, in that case, our fee will then go down. But on the other hand, it's what's good for the county. And right now, the county's been good enough to give us this work. We've located an office here in Graham. We pay rent here. We eat here. We come over here. I mean, we do everything. I'm sorry I don't move over here. I've got a nice house in Durham. I hope to create a lot of business here, and I hope to hire people from this area to work in our office here. And I'm trying my best to make that happen. But I mean, in the case of these projects, we're almost cutting off our nose to spite our face. But you know, you all have been good to us, and we certainly want to. Our job is to get these jobs. You know, I know you want to push the work to Alamance County, but tell you the truth, would you do it at the expense of having more expensive jobs? And that's the question you need to ask yourselves. And if that's the case, unfortunately, you can't legally limit it to Alamance County. And we did everything in our power to push this out to everybody more than we ever do on any other jobs. And if the contractors here are not interested, I can't go out and hold a gun to their head. So, you know, that's what we can do. So that's a little response there.
Well, it was just that, you know, the underbid of one contractor under nine other contractors that were within range of everyone, and the one come in with $40,000 less, you know, it just seemed a little bit.
That's true, but we feel good, confident that our drawings will stand up. We've had that same issue on the EMS. We brought that thing in on right on budget, right on time. So we'll stand by our drawings, our documents, right.
Okay.
If I could just address quickly just a couple of issues there. One is that state law requires that if projects are over a certain dollar amount, that we have a licensed architect or engineering overseeing those projects. There's another state statute that requires that if projects are over a certain amount, that we cannot use our own labor force to do those. That's why the maintenance department cannot do these jobs. Okay. Also, the third thing is that some of these jobs require certain specialties that our maintenance employees do not have. So, I mean, that's the reasons that you have to contract these projects.
I was in construction and maintenance all my life, and there's a lot of difference between constructing and building something and maintaining it. It's like night and day.
You don't have to know what those GS numbers are.
Of course,
numbers
a lot of these issues came from lack of the maintenance being kept up to date.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't have those off the top of my head as far as those.
When you get around to it, if you can email it. Just
we could do that. Right.
Forced labor statute and the...
Right.
Okay. Any more public comment? If not, we're going to do one and two first. So do I hear a motion that we approve number one and number two, the construction and the financing agreement?
I'll make a motion.
I have a motion. Do I hear a second?
So that's adopting the resolution Exhibit A.
Contract.
Exhibit A.
Financing.
I'll second. So all in favor of number one and number two, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, not one and two. Okay, number three is the Exhibit D, which says there's a possibility that we would have to increase 1 cent in order to meet our contract.
I don't see the word possibility in there. That's my whole debate.
Well, it says it will be no more under the
$0.99 is close enough.
So, and well. Anyway.
I know semantics, but I just don't like that door or that window.
All right. So, but at this time, I will entertain a motion to accept number three, which is a local government commission application. Do I hear a motion to accept that?
I'll make a motion.
All right.
Accept that.
I have a motion. Do I hear a second that we accept that? I'll second that motion. And all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Okay,
no.
We have
three no's.
We have three no's on that.
The difficulty with that board action is we can't move forward with these projects because we can't, which means all of these Group A projects come to a standstill and we don't move forward.
You mean to tell me you can't write this resolution without putting that in there? I don't believe that for a moment.
All we got to do is take it out.
The local government commission is going to require, the language can be modified in there.
We'll modify it. Tell them we're going to pay for it, but we don't have to raise taxes to do it.
Well, there is a possibility that taxes will have to be.
Not with my vote.
I'm just saying that in order to pay the debt service, there is that possibility.
We can save it. We can cut it. We can get rid of people. We can do a lot of things. We don't have to tell them we're going to raise taxes. That's what's wrong with this country now. Check and see if you can't reword that.
Let me do this if this is okay. Give me a second. You can move forward with your other public hearings. Come back to this one. I'll try to reword it that may be suitable to a majority of the board or all of you, hopefully.
Okay.
Because without approving this resolution, the projects are dead in the water now. And all the money that we have spent with the architectural firm has been wasted because we don't move forward with any of the construction
over 1 cent. Over less than 1 cent.
Okay. Thank you for your time.
All right. We're going to go to the Rural Operating Assistance Program funding, and that one is Jason Martin. Jason, do you want to address this?
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. What you have before you is once again our annual Rural Operating Assistance Program funding application, which I have completed and do have with me tonight. Just to kind of update the board on what exactly this funding is used for, It is used for transportation in the county's jurisdiction, and it's split up under three core categories. First is the EDTAP funding, which is Elderly Disabled and Disabled Transportation Program. Then the EMPL Work First, which is basically the Wheels to Work program through DSS. And then the Rural General Public program, which is more of a general transportation program. We are applying for both the formula funding, which we are set to receive, and then we're also applying for additional supplemental funding. The total amount would be $340,299 this year. You should have in your packets as well a copy of the proposed EDTAP allocation for 2009-2010. This is the sub-allocation underneath the EDTAP funding for the different services, different service centers. Also here tonight is Dennis Williams from ACTA, and then also I know Susan Osborne is here from DSS. I'm sure she can, they both can help answer any questions you all may have. And with this being a public hearing tonight, we are required to have a public hearing to complete the application process. Jessica Hill, our planner, is also here with some forms for if there's any folks here that wish to speak. We would also like to collect written comments from them tonight to submit with our grant application. Okay. That being said, I'll be glad to take any questions you all have at this time.
Okay. I don't have any for this. This is a grant. I have no problem with it. Does anybody have any comments? It's open for public comment on the grant that Mr. Martin is trying to obtain for EDTAP and supplemental.
There's no matching.
There is matching funds, but that is taken out of funding that's already given to, I believe, to
it's already
ACTA.
In the budget. Yeah.
It's in the budget every year.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. But that one, we will. Well, Tim is not up.
Do we need a whole recess?
He's supposed to be up here. I can just call for a motion, I guess, without him.
Okay, I'll make the motion and we accept it.
Okay. I'll second it.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
And he's not here, so that's another yes.
He should have been here.
Okay, the next one that we have for public hearing is the CDBG block grant, community development block grant application. If you want to explain that one.
Sure. Every year, counties, cities and counties that wish to apply for CDBG funding have to hold just a generic public hearing to kind of go over what the funding can be used for. As you all know, we have several projects and have had several projects under this particular program. We do have a housing project currently going on and an infrastructure project that I hope within the next week will be closed out here very soon. But just in general, the funds that CDBG funds can be used for, these are from U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. They can be used for community revitalization projects, which may include housing rehabilitation, clearance, relocation, infrastructure improvements, and recreational improvements, or infrastructure improvement projects, which could include water and or sewer. And then three, infrastructure improvement projects, which could promote economic development, all of which are designed to benefit low to moderate income citizens of Alamance County. There is no action required of the board tonight, so there's no vote or anything that needs to be taken. At this time, I'm in the process of looking at updating some of our community development information, which is a little bit old, and possibly we'll look at making another application this year for maybe an infrastructure project or community revitalization project. Okay. So.
All right. Thank you.
Jason, thank you.
Okay, the next thing on our agenda is the animal control ordinance revision, so don't go away.
I'm pulling triple duty tonight.
You are. Has everybody read this and understand it? This is a
it
animal
sounds
control
to me like we
ordinance.
I'll listen to the block talk.
Okay.
Just tightening the reins, Bill.
Yeah, this one thing I do want to kind of clear up on this is that, one, the this ordinance is already in effect. It's been in place. And at the request of the Sheriff's Department, and I believe that request was filed with the county manager and then down to me to look at updating this ordinance to make some amendments to tighten it up. And I know Major Britt was here. He's here tonight. I know he spoke with our planning board when we took this ordinance to the planning board, and he may be able to also help answer some questions with the logistics of how it's enforced, because this is not an ordinance that the planning department enforces. There, the two major changes that are being made under this ordinance is, one, in regards to public nuisance animals. Under the ordinance currently, it states that an animal shall be determined to be by an animal control officer to be a public nuisance when it commits any of the following acts two or more times, or two or more of the following acts at once. And it proceeds to say, chases, snaps at, or otherwise molests a pedestrian, bicyclist, motor vehicle occupant, or domestic animal, or scatters garbage or trash, or damages a garden, other foliage, or other real or personal property, or loiters on school grounds or on a public recreation area. The First Amendment to the ordinance was to delete that section out that says two or more times or two or more of the following acts. So it's, if it commits this, then they would receive a written warning. And that correlates directly to the second set of amendments under Section 5, which is on page 9 of your ordinance. And it's highlighted there, violations and penalties. We've struck out some language here. Any violation of the ordinance is misdemeanor punishable by a fine not to exceed $50. That was expanded out up to $500. And then the penalties are an escalating scale, which starts with a written warning. So it establishes contact with the owner of the animal. And then the second offense from there would be a $50 civil penalty, third being a $100 civil penalty, the fourth a $150 civil penalty, and then the fifth and each successive one after that being $500. And then also an imposition of a civil penalty for owning a dangerous dog. And in the ordinance, the dangerous dog is declared to be so if it attacks or injures a person or another animal. And that would also be a civil penalty of $500. With a failure, this next section under failure to pay, if it's not paid within 15 full days, then there could be an additional $50 attached to it, and it gives the county the right to pursue collection of the payments and delinquency charges through civil action. So that's the only changes to the ordinance. Everything else is still the same in it, and I'll be glad to take any questions that I may be able to help answer at this time. And then, as I said before, I know Major Britt is here too, maybe able to answer some questions.
Can I have a question?
Yes, ma'am.
I agree with what you have, so I'll say that up front. But is this, how enforceable is this? In other words,
very enforceable.
Scatters garbage or trash. I mean, how do you know whether it was my dog or his dog or her dog? You know what I'm saying?
You would have to do like any case. You would have to investigate. You have to prove and investigate. The problem with the ordinance now is you have to do it two or more times, document.
Right.
Then you warn. Then you write. Essentially, we send the same animal control officer out to the problem animal, not the good pets, four times before we can take the first action, and then it's a warning. We need something where we have that dog that's chasing the children, that dog that's going on school grounds chasing kids. We've got something we can move forward.
Yeah, I agree with what you have, and taking away two or more times is really ridiculous as far as I'm concerned. But how can you prove this?
Well, you have to, like any law or statute, you have to prove it by evidence, by seeing the dog, capturing the dog, doing witness statements. I mean, you know, certainly that doesn't mean we come out and the garbage is spilled and I go, well, Miss Vaughn's dog's the closest, let her run her up my other dog chicken. It don't work that way. We have to prove our case.
I'll bet if I seen her dog.
Hey, Sheriff, I ain't got a dog, okay?
Well, this happened on my road, Ann, okay? And however took care of it. So let me explain. They make you, and you have to see the dog, and you call them immediately, and they have to see the dog. So that's how you do it right there.
Yeah. And well, I mean, I agree with this.
You call the sheriff, and they send somebody down there, and the dog's still there. This dog on my ridge tore my neighbor's garden flowers up about 5 times, okay? And she is not a happy camper.
Well, she'll shut it.
Well, no, you can't do that either. You can't
shoot
canoe.
You can't if ain't nobody around.
Well.
Well, I don't
anyway,
agree with
the dog is going to have to be kept up now on the leash.
But then, I don't agree with tethering a dog either. To me, that's unfair to an animal, and that's why I don't have one. But what about a fence or one of those electrical things? That can't we move more in that direction rather than?
Well, this is not a leash law. These
I know.
Have to do something other than just make all.
If he comes and does it, what is business in my yard? I can't do a thing about that.
This requires the dog to take actions and nuisance, to chase people, to do damage. It gives us the ability to enforce action against animals that are creating problems. We're not asking for a leash law.
It's really not giving you any more authority. It's no. Just making it where when you go out there, you have a fine that you can impose.
Yes, as opposed, more
yeah.
Yeah.
The time. Under the old thing, that the animal control officer has to go out there 4 times before you do anything. Yes. You're wasting manpower, you're wasting gas, you're wasting equipment. And I can tell you, you can talk to pet owners 100 times, and 99% of the time, they're not going to always listen. So you'll be out there again. This just gives us something where we can move forward and take action to have to stop from going out 3, 4, and 5 times.
Jason, Edgewood is a prime example of that, where Kurt Lankford went out, 5 times?
Yeah.
5 times for this dog that wouldn't let the woman, a pit bull that wouldn't let the woman out of the car in her own yard. So, and I saw all these papers.
And I had a great day when they left the door to him. Well, my God.
But anyway, that's a prime example of Edgewood, and we have all those papers, and I have seen those, so... I think this will alleviate that situation of Mr. Lankford having to go to the same house 5 times. Okay, so any more questions on this?
No, I think.
Any more questions? Any more comments? Any comments from the public? This is a public hearing. It's not a leash law. Okay, if we don't have any comments, then I will entertain a motion to accept this revisions to the animal control.
So moved.
Have two so moves, and how about a second?
Second.
Okay, have a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. Okay, we're at this. Cheers. Yes, sir. Please do.
Give you a hard time, too. We don't mean to.
Appreciate you giving me a second chance.
Second round.
The worst legal minds in Alamance County have gotten together to come up with this language. Just wondering. Just kidding, Brad. Exhibit D, number 5. Take another shot at it. This sentence would appear at the end of Exhibit D, which is the resolution itself. Exhibit D. 5, the language that's in 5 would remain. However, there would be another sentence added, which is what I just handed to you, which would say, at this point, the Board of Commissioners are not authorizing a tax increase and will address any such issues through the county's normal budget process.
Fair enough.
Still playing a game, but I'll
ask again. Now, I hear a motion to accept Exhibit D with the added insert on number 5?
I'll make a motion.
I have a motion.
Insertion of that.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you. So now we can proceed with that. So now let's get on with the county manager reports. Mr. Cunningham.
Nothing really to report tonight, but I do want to thank Tim for all the work he has done in getting us to this point on these projects. You know, there are a large number of projects, large number of issues dealing with financing and the local government commission and dealing with the architect on a daily basis, and Tim really has done an excellent job on that, and I just wanted to publicly thank him for the job that he's done, but also publicly thank you for allowing us to move forward with these projects.
Okay. Thank you. Now we'll go to the consent agenda. Does anyone want to pull anything off the consent agenda?
Yes.
What is that? Okay. Ms. Vaughn wants to pull C off the consent agenda, and we'll discuss it now. That's the out-of-state travel request for the sheriff's office.
See, I think he likes coming up to the podium rather than staying back there, so that's why.
Well, he needs to be.
That's what he's supposed to be.
No, this is just for clarification, Sheriff. On the first one, talking about Randy Denham, Sheena Parker, and Dean Culler.
Yes, ma'am.
They're going to retraining school. Is this because of the?
This is the new stuff on the computer system for stats and things that has to be entered. It's not technically a retraining. It's just improvement in the programs that the federal government has developed.
Okay, I didn't know whether it had to do with the MOU or whatever.
No.
It's okay. Just clarification. Okay, on the second one, Robert Wilburn.
Yes, ma'am.
Academy.
This is the first Alamance County Deputy Sheriff that's ever, other than Mr. Britt, who declined 4 years ago to go to the FBI National Academy.
Yeah, we knew about that one.
Robert Wilburn has been accepted in the 240th Federal Bureau of Investigation Academy. They only cost us about the uniforms of $500, and we have never had an officer from Alamance County Sheriff's Department ever be accepted and attend the National FBI Academy. And I assure you, Mr. Wilburn will graduate.
He will do this. Can I ask you a question, too?
Yes, ma'am.
Is there like an entrance exam or something like that that they have to take to be able to go?
But they have one heck of a background they go through.
Check type stuff.
Yes, ma'am. And certainly with that is their ability to comprehend in that investigation.
Can I ask another question? Of late, I've seen some FBI Academy T-shirts out there. Mm-hmm. Now, are these folks with the FBI? Are they FBI wannabes?
They're probably FBI wannabes. You can get the sheriff hats, sheriff shirts. People make them, and that's probably what it is. Certainly they'll be given T-shirts at the Academy, and it will probably say FBI National Academy 240th graduating class. That is pretty much, you can rest assured that they are graduates of the Academy.
Okay, I was concerned because I didn't know, is it a process, is it something that you are endorsing?
Absolutely.
No, I'm talking about the T-shirts that we're seeing out.
Oh, no. We're talking about attending the Academy.
She wants one of your T-shirts.
No, I thought if you got somebody else one, I want one too. No. Yeah, I know you endorse the FBI Academy, and we do too, and congratulations to Mr. Wilby.
Well, I think for Alamance County, it's going to be very, very important. I'm very big on training, and Alamance County is growing. The national problems are growing for law enforcement. And having people to get this quality of training and other trainings that we're sending them to is a must today in law enforcement. And I'm just very proud that our people are willing to take that opportunity and turn it into a reality for this county.
Okay, one other question. Funding source, you have budget. Is it your budget? Is it the county budget?
It's going to be. The $500 will come out of my budget if I have to take it out of my pocket. I promise you.
It didn't stipulate, and I just wanted to ask.
I understand. Okay. I understand.
Again, congratulations to Mr. Wilbur.
Thank you very much.
Can we put that back on?
Oh, sure. Absolutely. Both of them back on the consent agenda.
Okay. Oh, thank you.
Any other consent? Anything else on the consent agenda that we need to take off? Okay, at this time, I will entertain a motion to accept the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. Okay, where are we? Let's see. Now we are to the commissioner's comments. So, do we have any commissioner's comments at this time?
I don't know if it's appropriate or not right here.
Wait a minute.
Jason had put something in on here about the roads that they came to us the last time about. And about the secondary roads, and I guess we're going to bring that up at a resolution next time. I don't see anybody here that was here last week, so I'll see if I can get in touch with Ms. Basin.
Okay, okay. Oh, are you talking about?
Over at Lakeview. Lakeview.
Yeah, yes. Justin has a letter on
He's
that.
Got the letter here. Yeah. And I just,
okay, yeah, we have a letter on that. Okay. Any other comments from the commissioners? Any announcements? All right. We are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.